It's almost, but not quite, Zen 430, so we've got a few minutes to kill.
Yeah, and in that time, I'm going to ask Wendell from Level 1 Techs about HEDT, high-end desktop.
I think it's gone. Kinda.
I do too, and because the thing is, like, earlier, the reason I wouldn't talk to you about it is because I said, like, I was talking about Threadripper HEDT, and then you mentioned sort of your HEDT thing, and it kind of set me off. You were saying memory capacity.
Yeah, I think if we're still at 128 gigabytes, that's really probably not enough, especially moving into a new generation platform.
So you're saying 128 gigs is not enough for an HEDT. That's like not even, that's like regular stuff.
Yeah, it's not enough of a spectrum, because even going back to X299, we could do 384 gigs. And even more than that, during the firmware snafu that Intel had, where you could use registered error correcting memory on X299, which happened in the 7000 series.
So you like, because I mean, the problem here is like, what is the meaning of HEDT? Because I like, honestly, it's like you said, like eight cores was HEDT. That was like the thing that made it. Eight cores is like in a $150 CPU these days.
Yeah.
So it's not really core count, it's about memory. That's...
Yeah, well, it's about memory more than PCIe now, because we might have solved PCIe. At this point, with PCIe 4 and 5, between bridges and chipsets, you can wire in a lot of peripherals. Not necessarily everybody's making a motherboard to do that yet, but if there's a market for it, there's a way to get it wired in. So even if we've got 24 PCIe lanes coming from the CPU, because they're all insanely fast, we could turn that into 48 or 96 lanes all the way down to PCIe 3 specs.
Yeah, and that was, of course, one of the key features of HEDT is more PCIe lanes, too. So you got 8 cores, you got more PCIe lanes.
Yeah.
And memory capacity does as well. And I guess the early, like, honestly, would you agree the first HEDT was Intel's Westmere Gulftown?
Yeah.
Tri-channel.
Yeah.
Big socket, up to 6 cores, eventually 8 cores in the same socket. But that really is sort of like the creator of the HEDT.
And that 8-core upgrade path was pretty significant, because not only did you get 2 more cores, but it was also significantly faster. And that was, you know, the nice thing. It's like, oh, I've gone to HEDT. There's a path for me. I can do this. And now, if you look at the very highest end of things in the market, you know, like a workstation, is so far beyond the pale of anything that there is kind of there's a gap here where HEDT could possibly fit, and there's a pricing gap too. I mean, you know, from less than $1,000 to a couple $1,000s.
Just on the CPU side itself.
Just on the CPU side itself.
I'm just thinking like the whole platform, and because the fact that we have basically 16 core Ryzen, we're gonna probably have 24 core 13th gen. The core count thing is not really a big deal. Like, where do you go? And then, but to me, 128 gigs of RAM, you would not consider 128 gigs?
There's no upgrade path. Like, 256 or 512 gigs is like, okay, that makes more sense. 256 even was a little bit limiting on 3970. So I started out with 64 gigabytes on a 3970 system and went to 256 gigs. And when I was keeping all the cores busy doing a lot of different things, it was a little bit of a stretch to get everything to fit in 256 gigabytes. But that was like big background jobs, big VM tasks. You know, you got 3 or 4 virtual machines running 16 gigabytes of memory that have different pressure on the memory. 256 gigs just doesn't go as far as it used to.
Okay. So beyond just capacity though, what about channels? Because that has also been like, HEDT has always been dual channel. Anything more has always been...
I would probably be okay if, you know, 2 channels probably is not enough, but 3 or 4 or 6 or 8 would definitely be better when we're talking about those kind of capacities. 6 is probably the sweet spot.
It feels like it, right? Because that's sort of the cost sweet spot, because you get up past that, I'm sure it gets substantially more expensive, more layers on the board, right?
Yep.
So it just gets pricier. So we've designed what Wendell's HEDT is. Is that dead then for most people?
Yeah, I think so. I think if you need HEDT, you're probably going to splurge and get the more expensive thing. And if you're an enthusiast, you're probably going to be happy with 16 or 24 cores.
Right, because it is just pretty hard to justify anybody. Like, that's why I think they killed Threadripper.
Yeah.
Because they would rather just have you buy the much more expensive Pro.
Yeah.
And then I guess if Intel ever makes an HEDT, would you consider Intel still in the HEDT market at all?
I don't think they're going to do it. I think they could have done it with like 3748, the previous Xeon socket. I mean, they were set up to do that with the 3175X, and they could have just said, let's rebadge some Xeons and have something at the HEDT market that's a move from X299, but they didn't do that, so I think they've decided it's dead.
Just because it's just pointless, because it'd be a butt-kicking against the... And I guess, is it Intel's fault AMD never did another Threadripper? Because if Intel said, like, hey, yeah, we're going to step to this, and then... I kind of think AMD probably would have made.
I think that if Intel does something, it'll probably be something Alder Lake-ish, maybe in a new socket, and maybe like 24 or 32 cores. Maybe we'll see 16 P cores and 24 E cores or something kind of monstrous like that. Maybe. It probably wouldn't be hugely expensive to qualify something like that, and then AMD might respond, but I don't think Intel's going to do it. I don't think they got the bandwidth.
Right. It's just not, it's not worth it at the moment, but I feel like the reason why it is essentially dead now, or at least it's sort of frozen in carbonite, is because there's no reason to compete.
Yeah.
So, but if Intel does that part with that core count, then AMD is probably going to get back into it. And
yeah.
Well, the battle will be on again.
If you look at holistically at, you know, we know Genoa is coming, and we know that that's going to be a fatter socket with more channels and blah blah blah. And you look at where we are with Threadripper and Epic basically being the same socket, Threadripper Pro. And then you look at AM4, AMD's facing that same kind of pressure that Intel had previously faced with the Ice Lake Xeon socket and the 3476, 3674, whatever that, the triple channel, dual triple channel socket was, and then the other sockets. So instead of having so many sockets in play, you know, AMD's probably going to face the same pressure. And so maybe Threadripper Pro keeps the older socket alive when all the server people move to the new socket. Maybe.
That'd be interesting. Now, we agree that for the most part, it's sort of frozen. Do you think there is a need, though, or?
There's definitely a need for the workstations. I mean, on the workstation side, they're selling them as fast as they possibly can. So the question is enough people not buying the workstation part to fill in that $1,000 to $2,000 CPU price gap? And I think the answer is probably no. I think if you were going to spend more than $1,000 on a CPU, you'd probably bump up to the other system. And if the constraints go away and the supply chain stuff goes away and everything else sort of changes, you know, we know that the motherboards actually, the Threadripper Pro motherboards are sort of cheaper than the enthusiast level original Threadripper boards. Think about like the highest end Threadripper boards over $1,000, and you can get a good Threadripper Pro motherboard for like $600-$700.
That's basically desktop.
Yeah.
That's high-end desktop. I mean, not high-end, but that's normal gamer desktop motherboard prices these days. That's really a shocker to me. I don't follow that too closely, but you can get a Threadripper Pro board for $600-ish dollars?
Yeah, through there somewhere.
And I guess you could argue like that, if you're getting you sink $700 on the motherboard, why don't you just get your 32-core, 64-core Threadripper Pro? Then you're not really...
Yeah.
Because it seems to me like there's no way that we see that segment between them unless Intel does something to sort of...
Disrupt things.
Which is possible. It is entirely possible. But for now, basically... HEDT is really dead. What true HEDT is dead?
There's not a part for enthusiasts. See, in the past, you would buy the 2950, and it was $1,000, and it was 16 cores, and it was a fire-breathing monster. And it wasn't perfect at everything, but gosh darn it, that was an insane amount of horsepower. And now it's like $100 a core. 16 core, $50 a core.
And the other thing, too, is like, so if you're basically buying Threadripper Pro, you're essentially getting Epic. These parts aren't really tuned to, like, climb for the stars.
Yeah.
I'm kind of wondering if, you know, like a 32 core really tuned for very, very high clocks, at least on some loads, if there's a market for that. I don't
know. Well, there definitely is, yeah, because the F series Epic, there's a whole other spin of the 32 core series Epic that are clock optimized, and those will boost up to like 4 gigahertz, 4.1 for the 8 core.
That's pretty good.
Yeah. But the 32 core Threadripper Pro was shockingly faster than the Epic 32-core, because I thought the Epic I think it's 75 F3, it's the F series 32 core. I thought it would be within spitting distance, but no, the Threadripper Pro is actually faster, and it's because it uses a lot more power. A lot more power for more cores. It's not dramatically faster single thread, but multi-thread.
It just comes out of socket power math, I guess, almost like, okay.
Yeah, and we see at least a couple of motherboard manufacturers for Threadripper Pro playing it a little fast and loose with the socket power, because they're giving the SoC, they're not really counting the power the SoC is using against the power the cores are using.
Okay. So they were getting, it's working pretty well, sort of like an ad hoc Threadripper replacement in a way.
Yeah, and that kind of thing would never be qualified in Epic, I think.
Yeah, and that's sort of the thing is, when you get to workstations, it's about being conservative.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess, would you also sort of build that into the definition of HEDT? Workstation is ECC, I don't want any bits out of place.
Yeah.
HEDT is kind of like, you know what, we can lose a few bits here and there, whatever, because we're clocking the hell out of this, we're going to let you overclock, and then that's sort of baked into the...
I think that has been kind of the model, too, because that opened up a whole other set of markets. You know, when Google was on their meteoric rise, it wasn't, oh, we don't need five nines of reliability, we're going to deal with that in software. So they were just using commodity stuff. And there's still a lot of that from the remnant HEDT market, I think.
Huh. Wow. Okay. Well, you know, I think it's actually time to go to our thing now, because it's almost...
Zen 4:30.
Anyway, thanks for coming.
Well, thanks for having me.
Wendell from Level 1 Techs, please go to his channel. Like and subscribe and smash that bell, I think, I've been trying to learn how to say that young thing. So please do that over there, and
thank
good
you.
To have you.
No, thank you.